Hi, welcome to the Quilt of Joy Clubhouse. And so it is April 17th, 2024, and I'm just really glad that you were able to join us today. I've got some really fun stuff to share with you. I hope that it is warm and sunny where you are here in Louisville, Kentucky. We're at like 82 today and sunny, and everything is blooming and looking beautiful, and the whole city is getting ready for the Kentucky Derby that's coming up in a couple of weeks. It's always the first Saturday in May, so hopefully you'll be able to watch the Derby if you aren't local. I do have a hat. I need to go get some ribbons and some, I think I've got some flowers, and get my glue gun ready and make my hat all swanky. I tend to do it as a DIY thing rather than going out and buying them. But there are hats abound in Louisville, Kentucky. So hopefully it is warm and sunny where you are. We have a big thing that's coming up this weekend. We have a lot of proms that are going on this weekend. We also have a big air show, and then it's called Thunder Over Louisville, and it's a big fireworks show all downtown over the Ohio River. And it's always a good time when you are in Louisville during Derby. And we have a lot of folks who are coming and hopping off the highway and coming to visit us here at the shop to see the Quilt Fairy headquarters. And so if you are traveling through Louisville, I sure do hope that you are able to hop off the highway and come and see us. And if you are local, then I sure do hope you've been able to find us and come and spend some time here with the Quilt Fairies. We have it all decked out and ready for spring. We've got a lot of great new things in the shop as well. So hopefully you will be able to join us. And if not, if you are too far away, I'm just glad that you were able to join us today here live as we chat with our sit and sew. So I would like to know where you're watching from. So put down there in the description where you are, if you are local. Karen in Virginia. Oh, I did have a great vacation. Karen, I've got some photos to show everybody too. Had a great vacation. Delta from Traverse City, Michigan. Hey, and Deborah in Oklahoma says, yay for spring. I know, it's nice, right? I think we're supposed to get colder here. It's supposed to go down to like 60 or something soon, but right now it's fabulous. Rebecca from Louisville. Hey, and Harleen says hi from cold and rainy North Dakota. Harleen, we had a woman stop in here. I know that South Dakota is not the same state, but same area. We had a lady stop in here yesterday from South Dakota. She said that her closest quilt shop to her is like an hour away from her home, and she was in Kentucky visiting a friend. So they ran over here and found a lot of great things to follow them home. Hopefully you have a quilt shop closer to you than that, Harleen. But thanks so much for joining us here today. And I did want to be sure everybody is signed up for our newsletter. So in our newsletter, we always remind you of our live streams, but we also notify you of any new arrivals that we have, or any workshops or tutorials or events that we have coming up. Everything that we think you would love to know is all in that newsletter. So be sure that you are signed up. Oh, and Cheryl from Jeffersonville. Hey, Cheryl, thanks for joining us. Jeffersonville is right across the river in Indiana, like 20 minutes away or something. So hey, Cheryl. And then if you have a moment, if you've enjoyed the Quilt of Joy Clubhouse, if you would leave us a review over on Google, the link is down there in the description of where you can go to do that. It really helps our little quilt shop grow. You know, we are and we have mighty dreams. And so sometimes it helps for folks to leave a review for a local shop, because it helps Google know who to show us to as the Google monster kind of takes over. So if you'd leave us a review, I would be very grateful. I do read each one of them personally, and I do appreciate your time in doing that. Julie from Columbus, Ohio. Hey, Julie and Beth in sunny Mesa, Arizona. Oh, Beth, I gotta tell you, I'm gonna show you what happened to me in Arizona on vacation, Beth. It was quite a thing. So I'm going to show you that in just a minute. And Linda in Fairbanks, Alaska. Linda, what is the temperature in Fairbanks, Alaska right now? I'm sure it is, let's see, it's early morning, mid-morning. Tell us what the weather is like in Fairbanks, Alaska. I'm going to see a friend of mine in June who lives in the North Pole. Like, so the North Pole, the city, so that's a little further south than the actual North Pole. But I'm going to get to meet her in 3D. To have quilty friends, and maybe you don't see them in 3D very often. or, you know, I've made lots of quilty friends that I've not yet met in 3D. And so this woman that I get to meet, she's going to be headed to a big event that we're having in Nashville in June. It's the APQS All-Star Retreat. And that is going to be a 2.5-day hands-on classes offered on APQS long arm machines. So if you have an APQS long arm machine and you're looking for hands-on classes, you might enjoy going to Nashville. There will also be classes at the All-Star Retreat that focus on the Quilt Path computerized system. And there'll be some other classes that are lecture demo. I will be teaching both days. I will be doing hands-on classes, and we'll have a classroom full of APQS millenniums, and we'll have a whole bunch of fun. So there's a link to that down in the description. There are still some spots available for that if you are interested. It's in June, it's in Nashville, and it's a whole retreat. So it's at a hotel, and all the accommodations are all included in the price. So there's other stuff too. We're gonna have night lectures. It's gonna be just a whole bunch of fun. So sometimes it's hard to find those long arm retreats anymore. And this one, APQS, is bringing in all these tables and all these machines to set it up for us in Nashville in June. So anyway, my friend Shanna, who lives in the North Pole, is coming to Nashville, and I will get to see her and meet her finally. So Linda says it's 30 degrees in Fairbanks, Alaska today. And I have no idea. Is that a warm day, Linda? I have no idea. I would presume that's a warm-ish day. I would presume. And Liz in Lake Griffin, Florida. Hey, Liz. Thanks for joining us. And I did want you to know that in each month, we have a different thread bundle that we feature. And in the month of April, we have the Serenity Sprite, and it's so pretty. So these are all glide thread. They're 40 weight polyester. And in this Quilt Fairy bundle, the Serenity Sprite, you'll find seashell, you'll find grotto blue, and sea mist, and they're just beautiful together. And we do have them at a special price, but it's only good for April, and then in May we'll have a new fairy that comes to visit us. So we have this both in the king cone size of glide, and we also have it in the 1,000 meter cone size of glide. So our quilt fairy, we have a different little thread fairy that visits us each month, and this one is Serenity Sprite. And then we did take, gosh, Jesse, which months did it? We took all of the sprites from which months?
It was, I believe, July 2022.
July 22 through December. And we deliberately had those thread fairies packs oriented so they go together. And we have released that in a collection, and that's the Enchantment Collection. And so those are all of those thread fairies together, and it's a beautiful grouping of colors. So if you're looking for a nice way to start a thread collection, either for your quilting, machine quilting, or maybe you enjoy machine embroidery, this is a nice way to get a good collection of glide where the colors are all meant to go together. It's just beautiful. Oh, and Emily says hello from the University of Kentucky. So Emily's my daughter. She's watching because we're going to talk about her here in just a minute, and I can't wait to show you why. So. Okay, so that's the Enchantment Collection. That's 18 cones of thread, and we have them at a special price if you're interested in those in both sizes. Okay, so since the last time that I saw you, which would have been in March, because we didn't have Quilted Joy Clubhouse that first week of April because I was on vacation. And so in March, I went up to Colorado, and I was able to, we recorded the 4400 series of Love of Quilting. And can you see this, Rachel? I've got a photo pulled up here of Sarah Gallegos and I on set. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So we had the 4400 series. We record that out in Denver, and we show how to make different quilts that have been in the magazine or will be in the magazine. And it's a whole bunch of fun just to spend the week there with Sarah and enjoy quilting together. What were we saying, Rachel?
I can see all your tabs on there.
Oh, okay. You can see where I'm looking for a KitchenAid mixer. Yeah, I don't know that I have a way to fix that. So there we are on set. You can see all of the cameras. You can see all of the lights and the microphones. It's a whole crew that gets us ready, including hair and makeup And it always astounds me, like, that hair and makeup takes like 2 hours every morning. Anyway, they get us all ready. It's nice to actually not have to worry about that. They take care of that for us. So there we are on set. And then afterwards, I went to the Grand Canyon. So I was telling, I've forgotten who it was that's watching from Arizona, the name of the woman who's watching from Arizona. So here's what happened. My husband met me in Las Vegas. And so after I left the recording of the show, we went to Las Vegas and we took a tour of the Grand Canyon. We got on a bus and it drove us to the Grand Canyon. And so we stopped at the Hoover Dam first and got to see that. And then you see there on the right of the Grand Canyon with the cactuses. What you don't see between those two spots is the bus broke down in the Arizona desert for like an hour. So we were, now I mean, thankfully it's March, right? So it wasn't screaming hot, but we weren't allowed off the bus because we were on a highway, and I guess the Department of Transportation won't let a whole busload of people hang out on the side of a road. But we were in the Joshua Tree National Forest. So we had pretty things to look at, but we were stuck on the bus. And so thankfully this bus broke down about 20 minutes away from the Grand Canyon. We were at the west rim of the Grand Canyon. And so they were able to go get a bus that had already dropped off their passengers at the Grand Canyon to come back and pick us up off the side of the road in the Arizona desert near the cactuses and the Joshua trees, and then finally take us to the Grand Canyon. And I had never seen the Grand Canyon. There's my husband and I at the Grand Canyon. This was my first time, and it really struck me, like, you know, it's big, right? But then, like, a helicopter would fly through it, and you're looking at this little tiny dot way down in the canyon, and you're like, that's a helicopter way down there. Like, it gives you just this perspective of how massive, just absolutely massive. And I've got a video there that we kind of climbed to the top, and you can see a helicopter there on the left if you saw as it went by. Just absolutely incredible. And then we went to, in Vegas, this is the Bellagio. So the Bellagio casino, it has this room that it switches out with the seasons, and everything's made with flowers. And so they had these large statues, is the only way I could describe it. It was a tea party. And so they had two of these statues that were like the hosts. And then each little quadrant of the room was a different kind of tea. And so the one on the right, that was the rose hip tea area. And it had water and little smoke, and everything's made of flowers. And of course, I was over on the dresses of these two statues, like looking at the lace that they had sewn onto the bodice, and the up there on the shoulders, the roses that they had made out of the satin, just absolutely gorgeous. And you can see on the right there, the statue that is in the moon, she actually has a teapot, and the water is coming out of the teapot, and then it falls down into the pool there in the rose hip tea area. Now the one on the left here, this is the lavender tea area. And so again, all this water and all the flowers, and it's lit really well, and they've got music in there. It's just absolutely gorgeous. And of course there's a billion people in there. My little heart, when I got into the elevator, look at how many floors were in the elevator. I know that y'all who live in a big city, this is no big deal, but if I get into an elevator and I see that many buttons, I tend to freak out. Now, we weren't, do you see where the penthouse was? I don't know what UPH on number 38 is. I'm guessing that's like the super duper penthouse. We were like on floor 3. We weren't in the penthouse, but it was fun to just see how many flights, how many stories there were in this hotel. A little intimidating though, for sure. Okay, and so that was Colorado, and that was getting stuck in the Arizona desert when the bus broke down. And while we were in Vegas, we went to see Cirque du Soleil, and we went to see this magic show, and we just had a really great time. And so one of the things that I wanted to be sure that you knew about is the next trip is actually the whole shop. We're all going to Paducah, and we have a booth in Paducah as well. And if you are going to Paducah, please come by the booth and say hello. The booth is booth number 1820, and we are in the main hall. So hopefully you'll be able to come and see us there in the booth. And if you are interested in an APQS long arm machine right now, we have some deals right now for you. So give us a call here at Quilted Joy, and I can walk you through those deals. Those are specials that we can't normally offer. It's kind of a special time of year. So if you're in the market or you know somebody who's in the market for an APQS long arm machine, give us a call here at Quilted Joy and we can walk you through what those specials are. And if you do have an APQS long arm machine, or perhaps you have a different brand long arm machine and you are looking for some education, we have our virtual beginning long arm class coming up on Saturday, May 18th. And I teach that through Zoom, so you don't have to travel here. And I do that so that I can record the class so you can watch it later, and also so I can use multiple cameras and get you close-ups of everything. So if you bought an APQS machine in the last year, that class is free for you. So you can take it anywhere. But if you haven't yet taken your class, I'd love to have you join me in class. So just give us a call here at Quilted Joy, 502-718-7148, and we can get you added to that class. Or if you have a different brand machine and you'd like to take that class for some long arm education, I'd love to have you join me in there. All right, so today we are going to talk about my new favorite quilt. You guys, this is so stinking cute. So I've got it pulled up here in EQ. This is by Elizabeth Hartman. And Elizabeth Hartman, I don't know if you've seen her other patterns, but they are just the most adorable. And so she just came out with this one. It's cats in pajamas, and we have two sizes on our website that you can get as a kit. So this is the small kit that I've got pulled up, and it has these diagonal plaids that are so fun, and then it has six kitties on it, and then it has a diagonal plaid golden binding in the kit as well. So that's a small version, and I want to say that's 55 by 55. Mm-hmm. And then there's a large version, and let me just show you the large version. Oh, that's a small. Here's a large. All right, I'm going to pull that in. So the large version, it has the diagonal plaids, and it has the smaller gingham fabrics as well in the kit. And here, Rachel, let me show them the gingham. So can you see it right here? So it has that gingham in it. So some of the kitties have the big plaid in the large kit, and some have the gingham. And so we put this with a turquoisey, tealy background in the actual pattern, the way that Elizabeth Hartman has it mocked up in her pattern. She has it on a pink. Sorry. She has it on a pink solid. And we chose a mottled teal fabric that you'll see here in a minute. And then, of course, you can make these whatever you like, however you want to put some personality into them. And so my plan, I'm going to pull up the small one again. So here's my plan. My plan is to make the small one. So it's a 55 by 55, and it's got six kitties. And I want to make each of the kitties the cats in my family and the cats who kind of walk through my life. So my daughter, Emily, who's watching, she actually has some really adorable kitties. Let me show the block first that I made with her kitty, Rachel. Let's see. So here's the block. Can you see that okay, Rachel? Yes. So here's the block, and this is Terry, Emily's cat, Terry. So Emily, she was fostering kitties with her partner who lives in, well, he was stationed in at the time in Puerto Rico, and they were fostering kittens, and they had two kittens that they fell in love with, and then they brought those kittens back to Kentucky. And those kittens, it's Terry and Theo. And so this was the kitten block that I made for Emily's kitten, Terry. And I texted her and I said, Emily, what are your cat's favorite colors? Because thinking, you know, I would choose that color for the pajama for each cat, thinking that she would roll her eyes at me and be like, favorite Kat's favorite. No, immediately she came back and told me, no, Terry loves pink and Theo loves darker colors, like brown or black. And it's like she knew exactly what her cat's favorite colors were, which I thought was pretty funny. So I was making this block last night, and I've got a photo here. Rachel, hopefully you can see it. So it is, I'm sitting at my sewing machine, and there is a bookshelf right next to my sewing machine. And this is Bruce, our cat Bruce, who was inspecting and watching as I was sewing all of my kitty blocks. And if you, we'll look at Bruce here in a minute, because I really looked at each of our cats and how to kind of replicate their look. So we were talking about Terry, that's my daughter Emily, and that's her kitten Terry that this block was made out of. And somehow she talks her cats into wearing costumes. I don't really understand how they put up with it, but they do. But if you look really carefully at Terry there on Emily's shoulder, the tip of Terry's ear was snipped, and that was because they do that for stray cats. So they want to be able to look out into a cat colony, into a bunch of stray cats, and see who has been fixed and who has not. And so when they fix a stray cat, many times they'll snip the ear during the procedure so that they can keep the colony safe and make sure everybody has been fixed. They can just do a check of the ears. So if you look at Emily's kitten that I did here in the block, I clipped the ear, Terry's ear, in keeping with Terry. So Terry has a pink nose, she has kind of a dark green eyes, she's an orange cat, and then of course her favorite color is apparently is hot pink. So that's the block that we're going to be working on, is we're going to be working on how to put together this face, because this face, if you look at it, it's got a lot of little pieces. So I'm going to show you some tips of how to make this Cats in Pajamas block. And again, we have this as a kit in the small size and the large size, and the large, I want to say, is 72 by 72. Yeah, 72 by 72, and it includes the pattern and includes these beautiful plaids and this teal background. And so the other cat that we're going to talk about that Emily adopted, I've got it here on the screen, Rachel. So this is Theo. And again, they're all about the costumes. And if you look closely, Theo also has his ear clipped, because he and Terry are brother sister. And so they came from the same colony. They were strays. And they when they were fixed, they had their ears snipped to denote that they were fixed. So we're going to work on a couple of cat faces. That's one of them. And then this is what kept me this morning. This is not a cat. This is what kept me this morning freaking out. So this is what I found in my backyard, a giant, I mean, I call it giant. It's a snapping turtle. And so from like nose to tail, it was like 2 foot long. And I have an outdoor cat and I didn't know where he was. And I knew that my outdoor cat was way too stupid to stay away from this turtle. So I had to run around and try to find my outdoor cat, because my outdoor cat would find this thing infinitely fascinating. And so here's the kitties. Here's my outdoor cat on the left. That's Oscar. That's the one that I was afraid was going to find the turtle. And that's the kitty that will be doing his face here together. But the one on the right, that's Bruce. And if you look, so Bruce Wayne, Bat Cat, do you see how his black, it's like a cowl. It's right at his jawline, and it looks like Batman. And so his name is Bruce, and I've got Bruce started here. So here's where I'm at with Bruce. Can you see it okay, Rachel? So I made his little kitty face, because he's got all black ears and black cheeks and black nose and that cowl line and then yellow eyes. So this is the beginning of his pajamas, and here is the background fabric, and you'll see how all this kind of goes together. So that's Bruce. So those are my kitties. So let's work on Oscar. And so Oscar is a black and white cat as well. And let me just get here all situated so that I can have a little bit of control in my environment. And I hope you guys enjoy this. If you've made an Elizabeth Hartman quilt, put down there in the description which one you've done, because I have not done it before. And I just had so much fun with her quilt. the pattern. I will say there's little pieces, so we're going to talk about some ways to kind of control all of that. So let me just open up my pattern here so that I can make sure I'm telling you correctly. So I've got Oscar. Let's see here, Rachel. So there's his face. So I need to do his eye. He's missing half his face. So here's one eye. I got to do his ears, and I do have his little nose and his cheek. So let's do his little eyes over here together. Now, the first thing I want to tell you is because there are so many pieces, but they're easy to put together. It's just hard to keep everything organized. So I want you to take a look at what I did. Do you have this? Do I have it oriented correctly? Rachel, yeah. So I don't know if you guys have seen this, but these are called G-Easy organizing stickers, and they come in different colors, and they're different sizes. So like these up here are square, and these down here are rectangle. And so they have either numbers or letters or sizes on them. And so with Elizabeth Hartman's pattern, I found it easiest to use the letters. It only goes up to M though, and I'm telling you, with this pattern, I went up to like, there's like a BB and a CC. There's a lot of pieces, and it was just gonna be almost impossible to keep everything oriented. So I took those little stickers and I just put them on my Wonder Clips, and they're just the right size. And now when I go looking for, you know, unit J, I know exactly who unit J is, because sometimes there's like, some are 2 1/4 inches by 2 3/4 inches, and then the next one will be 2 inches by, 2 1/2 inches. So it's really important that you have all of your pieces well labeled, and this makes it super simple. The other thing is that if you run into, so I told you I went up to like BB, or like here's one that was a T. Well, her letters on the stickers only go up to M. And so like this one was a T. So I just took a Sharpie and I just wrote on it, and now I have a T. And then you can see I have all of my stacks of everything here inside. So if I'm looking for the T one, I know exactly where to go. Even down to like here's P. So I had to write because it didn't go up that high. And here I have all of my P fabric pieces grouped together. And it just makes it so much easier to keep everything together. So if you haven't seen those or haven't tried them, we'll put a link in the description to find them, because we have them on the website. But I would say this is one of those crucial things. I would hate to try to do this quilt without some organizational label something. And this was a great way to do it. And it comes in different colors as well. Oh, Gina says, said Oscar's fabulous. You know, Gina, Oscar agrees. He thinks he's pretty fabulous too. He's just not stupid enough to stay away from that turtle. So that's why I had to grab him this morning. Okay, so so Oscar has a gold eye. So let's do the first piece. So we're gonna take, so I have an A and an E, and of course all the sizes are in Elizabeth Hartman's pattern that you'll need. So we're gonna just sew these two together. And these are pretty little pieces. So before you cut this out of yardage, I would definitely give it a nice spray of a fabric conditioner or a starch. And I'm gonna show you the one that I used. So I used this magic spray. Can you see that okay, Rachel? I use this magic spray, and this particular bottle, hopefully we can put a link in the description, Jesse, because it's really easy on your hands, because it's not like a traditional spray bottle. It's just much easier to spray a mist. And I would do it right now, but I would spray the camera here. I've got a piece of fabric right here. So what I would do with all these little pieces is first condition the fabric with starch, and give it a nice healthy dose of starch. Nice healthy dose. And so this conditioner, this magic spray, I'm gonna let it kind of dry. We'll let it dry on the yardage a little bit, and then flip it over and actually iron it from the backside. And that will that will get the fabric to be a little stiffer. And as you cut these little pieces, because like the eyeball is like 1 1/4 inches. I mean, he's a little guy. And so if you are able to really starch that yardage, and I would keep going until this dries, if you're able to really starch that yardage well, it'll help you when you go to cut out these little pieces. Okay, so I've got his little eyeball here. And I want to show you the next little tip I have, because these are such little tiny pieces. So there's this little guy here. Can you see that okay, Rachel? So this is a fabric folding pin, and it is, who makes it, Jesse? Is it Clover? It's Clover or Dritz. And so what it is that you open up this pin and you put water in, down more like this. Okay, so you take the top off and you fill it with water and you put a few drops of the conditioner that comes with the fabric folding pin in, like 4 or 5 drops. You just need 4 or 5 drops. So the fabric folding solution that comes with it will last you for a while. So fill it up with water, 4 or 5 drops, put the lid back on. And now you've got this like felt tip to it. And so all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna paint that seam. And I'm actually gonna put the seam to go towards the black. So whichever side, if I want to make sure that my seam goes in a certain direction, and in this case, I don't want my seam to go towards that yellow because it might shadow, I want it to go towards the black. Whichever side you want it to go towards, put that color, put that fabric up top. And now I'm just gonna push it to the side and hit it with an iron to dry that solution. And it really dries so flat. And when you're talking about the number of seams that we have in each of these faces, each of these little kitty faces, that is really necessary to have a nice flat. It's a beautiful crisp. And I know it feels like an extra step, you know, to paint each of these seams and then hit it with an iron, but I'm telling you, it makes a humongous difference. It is worth the time and effort. Okay, so I've got Oscar's little eye. And now what I need to do is I need to put the D piece. So I've got my D piece. Again, it's, I don't know how you do it without organizing yourself in some way. So this one goes on the bottom. And I do have on this foff, I have a laser. And sometimes on camera, it'll wiggle at the camera, like blink. But to your eyeballs, it doesn't. It has to do with the frame rate on the camera. Are you picking that up at all, Rachel, or is it? You can't see it on the fabric.
I can see it on the fabric.
So if the frame rate of the camera and the internet is showing you blinky lights here, just know in person with your eyeballs, you don't see that. But having that the light down here, you'll see how advantageous it is in a minute. Okay, so let's go back to the iron and paint that seam. I've got it the direction I want it to lay. I have that fabric on top, and then I'm just going to hit it with an iron and dry that solution. And so the solution that comes with a fabric folding pen will really last you a long time. All right, so this is Oscar, and he needs the letter F. He needs the letter F right here on top of him, and this will be the other side of his little face. So let's just do a 1/4 inch seam. And I will say that on this pattern, the Cats in Pajamas pattern, I did find that a scant 1/4 inch, when she says a scant 1/4 inch, she absolutely means it. So if you are new to your machine, definitely test your seam allowance and make sure that you are using a scant 1/4 inch. All right, I'm gonna paint that seam. I've put the fabric up top that I want it to in the direction that I want this seam to lay, and then hit it with an iron, and that will be one side of Oscar's face. So the first side here, and then there's a rectangle of fabric, and then we'll put his eye on this side of his face, and then we'll add his little chin. All right, and of course Oscar, as all cats are wont to do, he has a, you know, nickname. So he doesn't always go by Oscar. He goes by Noodles. He goes by Noodly Doo. He goes by Boo Boo. This morning he went by Snapping Turtle Hunter. Last night he tried to catch a chipmunk. He's a busy guy. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and cut that, and then let's take that over to the ironing station. So I have a choice. I can, about how I want to lay this this seam. I could lay it towards his eye, but do you see how much bulk is right there? If I flip it over, do you see there's not much here? It's just that one seam. So it's gonna make the most sense to have this seam get flipped towards this plain rectangle fabric. So I put it on the top, I'm gonna flip it over, I've painted that seam, and then I'm gonna hit that seam with an iron to get it laid nice and flat. Okay, so now we have Oscar's eyes, and I had already done the cheeks. He's gonna wear pink pajamas. He's a strong man. His my dad, one of his favorite colors, my kid said, was pink. So Oscar's gonna take after my dad and wear pink jammies. But let's work on Oscar's ears. And so Oscar's ears are it's a rectangle. And then notice that the way that she has this written, so we're gonna sew diagonally. But do you see that these are not the same size? Normally, if you were going to do a flippy corner, which is what we're going to do to put an ear on him, you would actually have this top fabric be the same size as your background fabric. But this really interesting thing happens when you don't. So here's the half when I do Theo's little face. Here, let's move him down. I want to show you Theo's little face. So here is, move over, Oscar. Here is Theo's face. We saw Theo before, and I have one ear done. So, but what I want you to see is that when you sew on the diagonal to create that flippy corner, but he's slightly smaller, he's not the same size as the background fabric, you get this little air gap here. And so that's gonna look, when you sew this block together, that's gonna give those ears a really nice point where you won't be able to cut the ear off as you go to sew the blocks together, because it's kind of been built in, this little gap's been built in so that you don't make a mistake. Of course, on Theo, I'm gonna deliberately cut his ear off. And on Theo, what I did is I took, it's a 2.5-inch square, and I just added a little strip of the background color to it, and then trimmed it up so it's 2.5 inches square again. And so let's take a look at Theo. If we wanna put Theo's ear on, so we would be sewing from diagonal to diagonal. But before I do, I just want to test it and see if I've got it oriented on here correctly. So you can see I do not. That would not give me what I want. So let's rotate this. I'm going to rotate it 90 degrees, and I'm going to flip it back because I want his ear to be clipped just like his sister. Again, that would not be the orientation. And so just test it. Just go around. That's not the orientation. That's the orientation. Do you see how that's going to give Theo his little clipped ear that I showed you in his photo? So that's the orientation. I would lay it down just like that, and then I would sew it from corner to corner. So let's do that. Let's take it to the machine and let's sew Theo's little ear on. And I have the grid on my faff. Can you see that, Rachel? Yeah, so I have the grid on the 45 degree angle. And so I'm not gonna actually mark that seam. I'm gonna start, I'm gonna start right here at this corner. So I'm gonna align the straight line in that corner. So not this corner, this corner, because this square is smaller than the background. So I'm gonna start at this corner, and I'm gonna use the diagonal grid to help line up. I'm actually using this edge of the seam with that edge of the diagonal. And now, when I sew, I'm only gonna worry about that grid line, and then as soon as my line can reach this point down here, now I'm just watching that corner. And so that 45 degree line can help you if your size is bigger than what the little projection line, the little, red line will show you. It's not a real laser, it's just a light that they've made skinny. Don't get alarmed, it's not a quote unquote laser. Okay, so let's check Theo's ears. So if I fold this back, that's going to give him, just like he is, he's got a full ear, and then he's got a partial, a little snipped ear to show that he was a stray kitty. And in the, I'm just going to go ahead and cut that a quarter inch away from the seam line with some scissors instead of a rotary cutter. So that little snipped ear will show that he was a good kitty who got fixed in the colony. Of course, he got more than fixed. He got to come to Kentucky, and now he lives a spoiled life with my daughter in Lexington. Okay, so there is Theo's ear. So I'll put his ear on. Let's see what happens, though. I want to show you with Oscar's ear. I'm going to set Theo here aside. How to do the ears if you don't need, a snipped ear. So I'm just going to lay these down. Notice that I have some of that background fabric kind of peeping up. I'm going to take it back to the machine. And if you don't have a projector on your machine and you don't have a grid, especially a grid that rotates 45, that's pretty darn cool. Let me just show you a product that you might really, really dig. It's called diagonal seam tape. And it looks like this. And so it's washi tape that has a center red line and then these two quarter inch lines away from the center red line. And there's quite a bit of tape on here. It's a 10 yard roll. This is made by Cluck Cluck Sew. And we have this in the shop. We'll put it down there in the description too. So imagine you could take this tape and you could put it on the bed of your machine with that center line, that center red line, oriented with the center needle position of your machine. And then the black here shows you where your quarter inch seam is. So you can pull those lines way out toward you so that you could actually do really large sewing on a diagonal and not have to mark it with this diagonal seam tape. So like this projector that I have on the machine is fabulous. However, it's only so big, right? So it's not gonna do me a whole lot of good for, like, if this was a giant, 10 inch, 12 inch that I wanted to sew a diagonal on. So in that case, that diagonal seam tape would be advantageous. And then just look down there in the description and see if you can find it down there. All right, and then I'm just gonna trim that up. I would use a rotary cutter normally, but let's just cut a quarter of an inch away from that seam, and we'll have Oscar's little ears. So Oscar is, I think he's 15 now. He's a tomcat, and he spends part of his day outside. His best friend is our next door neighbor, and he likes to go out and garden with our next door neighbor. And when they get home each day, he goes over and he jumps in their car and he says hello and welcomes them back to their house. Thankfully, they like him a lot, because if they didn't, it would be a problem. But he is their new best friend. All right, so here's Oscar's ears. There's his face. And then I've already done his little mouth and nose. So just a simple seam to put those three together. And I'll have Oscar's little face done. Let's talk about his pajamas, though, because there's another piece of this pattern that I really think you would appreciate a few tips on. So to make the pajama unit, let me grab Terry again, just so you can see what we're talking about. So let's take a look at Terry's pajamas. So you see that you've got this large piece of her pajama fabric, and then you have kind of a trim, a skinny piece here, super skinny, and then you have another rectangle here. And so that strip set, basically, you're going to sew this large piece to a skinny piece to this other rectangle to get the body of her pajamas. All right, let's look at her feet. Let's look at her legs. So her legs are also made with a strip set. There's a strip of the pajama fabric, a strip of the trim fabric, and then a strip of her foot fur fabric. And you make a strip set, and then you cut them into the actual legs of your cat. So what I have here for Oscar is I have his pink jammies, and I have his trim that I'm going to do, which is this gingham kind of royal blue trim. And then Oscar has white socks. So rather than black fur for his little feet, we're going to do white. So we're going to make a strip set, and then we're going to subcut this into his little feet. But I want you to notice how skinny that is, right? How skinny that is. So again, starch your fabric really well, or condition it with that magic spray. And I'm just going to start a little spider here. All right, there's a little piece of fabric just to hold my threads. And then I'm just really watching. I have my quarter inch foot on, and I'm really watching the edge of this foot, and I'm just keeping the fabric right at that edge. You may find that there is a foot for your machine that actually has like a little gate or a little flange right here, and that may be super helpful because it kind of keeps you from wandering. But I'm really letting those feed dogs do all the work. I'm just kind of guiding the fabric. I am not pushing the fabric. I'm not pulling the fabric. I'm just letting the feed dogs kind of drive that fabric into the foot. I'm just watching to be sure that I keep the edge of that fabric right at the edge of that quarter inch foot mark. So there's the strip set. And again, that's pajamas and that blue and then his white fur. And so this is where that fabric folding pin is really gonna be your friend, because it's such a little piece of that trim, that gingham fabric. And you want this to really lay flat. And when there's a little tiny strip of fabric like that, it can be hard to talk it into laying flat. So I've painted that seam. I'm gonna push it towards the direction that I want it to lay, which is towards his little feet. And then I'm gonna hit it with an iron. Okay, so now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna subcut this into 2.5 inch strips. And that will give me his little feet. And I'm gonna have to do this oriented towards me, Rachel, because I don't think I can cut this upside down. And I have a number of different rulers. I'm trying to find the one that I love. And I thought I had put it in here. And it's a larger, it's a Creative Grids ruler. Oh, here it is, here it is. Okay, so the first thing that I wanna do is I wanna do a cleanup cut. Let me just get things out of the way here. So the first thing I want to do is I want to do a cleanup cut, and I'm going to try to find as many little marks to line up with my ruler as I can. So I've got this on my ruler lined up with this gingham cuff, and I'm going to just do a cleanup cut, just a little tiny sliver here off the edge of the strip. So a little bit tiny. Now I know I have an edge here that's nice and crisp that I can trust. So I'm going to flip this around, and I told you these need to be 2.5 inch wedges. So rather than cutting 2.5, 2.5, 2.5, 2.5, instead I'm going to try to make as few subcuts as I can. So 2.5 plus 2.5 is 5, right? 5 plus 2.5 is 7.5. All right, you see where I'm going? So if my first cut here is on the 10, if my first cut is on the 10, I'm preserving this line, this cut line that I trust. I trust this line that I just cut. So the first cut I'm gonna make is 10 inches away from it. So 10 inches away from it. Now, we said that 2.5 plus 2.5 is 5, 5 plus 2.5 is 7.5. So I'm gonna bring this down to 7.5. And again, I'm gonna line up as many things as I can. And I've got my 7.5 here, and I'm gonna make a cut, and that will give me that 2.5 inch strip. Now, 7.5, what's 2.5 inches away from it? 5. So I'm gonna bring my 5 down, and I'm preserving that cut line, because every time you cut, every time you trim, you take the chance of disturbing or not cutting straight. So by preserving that line that I trust, now I can just keep on going down my strip set, and I know I'm going to be nice and accurate. Okay, so now I have Oscar. I have his little feet. But in the pattern, what I need to do is put, let's see if I can get, well, here, I'll get Terry. So if you look on the feet, you have the background fabric on the bottom of the feet so that the feet can go in and not look just like a block. All right, so here's the thing, is that the fabric that you use for that is really tiny, really, really tiny. These are 1-inch squares. So what I want to show you is some tips. If you are doing any kind of diagonal seam with little guys like this, I want to show you a couple of things. So I'm going to scratch that in place, and I still have that line on my machine showing, so I don't need to mark my diagonals. If you don't have this, you could use the diagonal seam tape. You can mark it with a pen. A lot of people like to use the Frixon pens, which is fine here because it won't show in the final product. Here, let's do one more of his little feetsies. It won't show. It's not going to be left in there. You'll be actually cutting on that line. So you would draw a line. You draw a diagonal line with a heat-away pen. And then, because it's on the wrong side and it's going to be not seen from the front, it's not like you have to worry about that line coming back. All right, I'm just going to, for speed's sake, cut these out. Okay, so here's the problem. Here's the difficulty. When you have a little tiny 1-inch square that you are trying to make a flippy corner out of, have you ever done this and it just, like, you lay it back and it just doesn't go, I did a pretty good job, but a lot of times you see it and it's not quite, it doesn't quite reach. So here's my tip. You know that this white fabric, you cut it correctly. So leave the white fabric intact and just peel back the white. So now all I have is this background fabric. And then I'm just going to cut 1/4 inch away from my seam line. So now when I flip this back, I will have left the background fabric in the piece, right? There will be 2 layers of fabric here. It's such a little corner though. Do you see how it preserved? You can see a little bit. Can you see the white peeping out, Rachel? Very small, but that little small difference will make a difference in all, as you do all the feet of your cat, that little tiny amount over 4 feet will add up. So leave the background intact and just push that flippy corner over. I'm going to do it one more time over here. So I'm going to leave the background intact and then I'm just going to cut away. And I did this on their little nose too, because the little nose fabric on Oscar, I don't know where Oscar ran off to. Here, we'll show you on Theo. So the little nose is also a little 1-inch strip. And so I left the background fabric and just cut away the excess nose fabric because I know I can trust the background fabric. All right, let's go ahead and iron that over. And especially on these little pieces, again, you're really going to want to make sure that this fabric folding pin is going to make such a big difference in the success you have with this pattern. And don't let the pattern, you know, there's a lot of pieces. Don't let it intimidate you. Just make sure you get organized. And it's super fun to customize it. And of course, that's what I'm doing. All right, we need to put one more little tiny square on each side. So did anybody see if they've done an Elizabeth Huffman quilt?
No. I did have a question. Someone had asked what the quilt behind you was.
So the quilt behind me is Fuzzy Love, and this one is in the January-February edition of Love of Quilting magazine, and we have this as a kit, and it's really simple. It's really simple piecing, you guys. Super simple piecing. The block goes together really fast, and then we have an embellishment kit that you can add to it if you want, that has the chenille for the whiskers and the cutie little button noses. So everything you need in that kit. In the kit, we've put it in with fabrics that are super fun, little kitty fabrics. Some of them have little fish on them. They're just stinking cute. So anyway, if you're interested in that, there's a link down there in the description where you'll find our Fuzzy Love. It's been a very popular kit for us. Okay, so let's get this out of the machine. And I'm going to cut that off and I'm going to peel back the background, cut this excess 1/4 inch away, preserving the background. And now when I flip that out, I know that I've made this the proper size. Even if I have sewn a little cockeyed on that on that diagonal. And these will be two of Oscar's little feet with his white socks as he runs around chasing turtles. I think my neighbor, my husband said my neighbor found a plastic tub and took the turtle and is going to go put him in the pond. There's a number of ponds in our subdivision. I think that's where the turtle wandered off from. Okay, so there's Oscar's little feet. So I just have to do the last things left to do is I've got his, here's Oscar. So I've got his little jammies and I've got his trim, but I want you to notice, here's the tip of his tail. I still have to put his tail, the rest of his tail over here. But take a look, she's got him going both left facing and right facing. And that way when they come up the quilt, some kitties are headed that way and some are that way. So you do have to pay attention to which of your cats are gonna be right facing and which of your cats are gonna be left facing. So I'm gonna make Oscar, he's gonna be a left facing kitty, a left facing block. So I really do hope that you guys, if you have a cat lover in your life, they would absolutely love this. In the pattern, you could even just make a pillow if you just have one cat, if you just want to do one cat. My plan is to do all of our kitties in our little world. So Emily's two kitties. I have three-ish kitties. I have an extra kitty that I might do. He's all gray. But one of the kitties I have has a really stripy tail, kind of like a raccoon. So I got to find just the right fabric for that. So hopefully you are able to make one. And if you do make a Cats in Pajamas quilt, put it over there in the Quilt of Joy Clubhouse, because I would love to see what you decide to do. And remember that we have it as a kit in both the small version and the large version. Get yourself some of these organizing stickers and these clips and that fabric folding pen and maybe that diagonal seam tape, and it'll make all of these little flippy corners that you're going to do so much easier, you guys. All right, so we will have our Quilt of Joy Clubhouse. We're going to meet again on Wednesday, May the 1st at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. And do join us over on Instagram. Make sure you are following us on Instagram. We're going to have photos from Paducah. I'll put up photos of some of my favorite quilts over on Instagram. And then follow us. Make sure you're following us on Facebook as well, where we're going to show some Paducah quilt show fun on Facebook. And then, of course, you can always go back and rewatch this episode and all of the episodes of the Quilt of Joy Clubhouse over on our YouTube channel. So if you need a little help and you're going to put this quilt together, you can watch those tips later on. So, and then we're going to have our sit and sew on Wednesday, May the 15th at 1 o'clock Eastern. Just join the newsletter and we'll remind you about all of this. All right, you guys, I hope that you have a fabulous day and I hope it is nice and sunny, even in Fairbanks, Alaska. And I will see you guys in a couple weeks. All right, see you later. Bye.